Hello everyone. I don't know how many of you have listened to the total class till the half class which we have done yesterday. So I thought that I'll just reshoot everything and send it to you so that it will be easier for you people to follow. So the first thing what we are going to discuss in today's class is renewable energy sources, and why are we going for the renewable energy sources when we already have non-renewable energy sources. So the first thing which we are going to see is renewable energy sources. Till now, whatever the first two chapters which we have seen, basically thermal and nuclear are non-renewable energy sources. Those are the plants based on the non-renewable energy sources, and hydro is a renewable energy source. And from now onwards, whatever we are going to see, those are all based upon renewable energy sources. So first thing is, we need to learn the basic renewable energy sources, the development of the solar by solar radiation, the development of wind energy, the applications of solar and wind energy systems, the study of biomass, geothermal and ocean energy technology. So these are the objectives for today's class. So not for today's class, for this total presentation, whatever we're going to see. This is a brief presentation which gives us a description of different forms of energy and how they are being implemented. So what is a renewable energy? Generally defined as the energy that is collected from resources which are naturally replenished on a human scale, such as sunlight, wind, rain, tides, waves and geothermal heat. So these are the renewable energies. This is the general definition of the renewable energy. These are replenished over a time. That means if you are going for, like, let us say for example rainwater, if we take rainwater, it is a continuous cycle through which we can again and again get the rainwater once the rainwater which we have collected is being used. So in that way, they are calling this type of energy as a renewable energy. Okay, these sources are normally used to produce clean energy. Here, whatever the energy we are going to produce are nothing but clean energies. These energies are they do not give us any pollutants, or they do not pollute the environment as the others do. Okay, so in this slide you can see the different types of energy. Starting from the left bottom, we can see the solar energy. Okay, solar panels are there, which is converted into electricity, and we can see that cycle. And if you come to the middle of the slide, we have on the top we have the wind energy, symbolized by the wind turbines. And in the bottom we have ocean energy, which in this ocean energy again we have two types of energies, that is tidal energy as well as wave energy. Okay, ocean wave energy. The thing is, there is a slight difference between the tides and waves that we'll see when we come to the ocean energy. Okay, and again on the right side of your slide you can see biomass. Biomass is nothing but the products which we get from the agricultural waste or anything, and again that product is again refined and used as a fuel to produce electricity. That is biomass. And next is geothermal energy. Geothermal energy is nothing but taking the latent heat which is present in the core of the earth and then using that to produce electricity. That is geothermal energy. So these are the different types of energies which we will be studying throughout our course. Okay, then coming to the non-renewable energy sources, the most non-renewable energy sources are fossil fuels such as coal, petroleum and natural gas. These are the basic three non-renewable energy sources. Basically, petroleum and natural gas are found at one place and coal will be found at another place. So these are the non-renewable energy sources. The main concept behind the non-renewable energy sources is that it will be replenished over some millions of years. It cannot be replenished like within a year or two. They can be replenished, but they will be replenished over some millions of years. That is why they are called as non-renewable energy sources. Now, renewable energy is growing in importance and popularity. Why is the renewable energy growing in importance and popularity? Means because of the desire and necessity to avert irreversible climate change. Because of the use of the non-renewable energy sources, we are getting different types of byproducts, which are pollutants that are released into air and earth. This is causing a irreversible climate change, irreversible climate damage. So, in order to curb that, in order to reduce that, we are going for renewable energy sources. And the extraction of oil is also getting higher and higher prices because of the extraction process. It is becoming scarcer and scarcer. The oil is becoming scarcer and scarcer, because of which the oil in prices are being increased. That is the second point by which we are going for the renewable energy sources. Now, and the third point is because of unreliability of non-renewable resources. That is what we were saying, right? These coal mines and oil mines, whatever are present, those will be depleted in the near future. So if we do not have any certainty that these non-renewable energy sources are going to be present in the future, we have to look for an alternate. That is why we are going for the renewable energy sources. Okay, next, can reduce our dependence on fuels and energy from foreign governments. The thing with this non-renewable energy sources is that these cannot be found in one particular area. They are spread throughout the whole world. So whenever you need an extra amount of fuel, which we need, and all those things, then what happens is we need to depend on other governments to produce, to provide us that fuel. So if we go for the renewable energies, these can be found anywhere in the world. These can be found even in our country itself. So we need not to depend on any other person or any other governments to give us the fuel and everything. So it will be we will not be dependent on anyone. We will be independent. To increase our independence, we are going for the renewable energy sources. Next, renewable energy facilities generally require less maintenance. The main cost when we come for the maintenance cost comes from the fact that the fuel is being used. When we come to the renewable energy sources, the fuels which we get are found naturally. We do not have to again extract the fuel from the ground or anything, or collect the fuel from a wide area or anything. So as the cost of the fuel is reduced, the maintenance cost will also be reduced. That's why renewable energy facilities generally require less maintenance. Okay, next, their fuel being derived from natural and available resources reduces the cost of operation. That is what we are saying. Because of that, the maintenance is also reduced and the cost of operation is also reduced. That's why we are going for the renewable energy sources. What are the different types of renewable energy sources? That is what we are going to see here. Basically, these are the five main types in which the renewable energy sources are being used as our main source. Here, solar energy, wind energy, hydropower, biofuels and geothermal energy. These are the five basic types of energies which we are used. There are many sources of renewable energy, but all of them except geothermal are more or less directly related to sun. Okay, the main source of clean and sustainable energy for the earth. So, okay, this statement says that here, except geothermal energy, all the above energies are somewhere more or less directly or indirectly connected to sun. Why is he saying that? Means solar energy, we know it is directly given by the sun. We know that, we don't have any problem with that. And while coming to the wind energy, how is the wind energy a related to sun? Means generally, what is wind? We need to understand generally what is wind, right? Wind is nothing but flow of air molecules from one pressure area to other pressure area. That's all, right? From one area to other area. When does this flow come? Means when there is a difference in the pressure in a particular area and the other area. This difference of pressure is created by difference of heating temperatures. That means if we have like a heat, if the heating temperature in one particular area is high, if the temperature is high, that means we'll have less pressure there, because of which the cold air will be, the flow air of will be flown from a colder area to that area. So how is this temperature difference, how is this pressure difference is being created? Means this is created by the uneven heating of the earth atmosphere by sun. Okay, because of the uneven heating of earth atmosphere by sun. That means wind energy is nothing but a byproduct of solar energy. Okay, next, how is this hydro energy a byproduct of solar energy? Means hydro energy derives from the rainfall and everything. How does the rainfall occur? The water needs to get evaporated. How does the water get evaporated? By solar, by heating it. That means again, it is hydro power is also a byproduct of solar energy. How are biofuels being byproduct of solar energy? Means what is biofuel? Actually, the agricultural waste which are being produced is called as biofuel, right? Those are the basic things which we would be using for the biofuels. So agricultural waste, agriculture to be, you know, growing and everything, the plants to grow and everything, sun is the basic thing. Sun is the basic energy through which they will derive the energy and grow. So biofuels are also nothing but a byproduct of solar energy. That's why mainly our all renewable energy sources are dependent on sun. So, sources of electricity in India. So, this pie chart is showing the sources of electricity in India. If we just look at this pie chart, the main slice of this pie is covered by coal. That means whatever the amount of energy we are getting is basically a thermal energy. That means coal is the basic ingredient which we are using. And again, if we go on looking at the different percentages, here hydro is 15%. Renewable energy sources is 13%, natural gas is 9%, and nuclear is 2%. Our main goal is to make the renewable energy sources the largest part of the pie. That means we need to increase the renewable energy sources, plants and everything. Okay. Next, here he is showing the installed capacity for different sources of power. Okay, here also we can see that the thermal is leading the total chart with 195.6 gigawatts. That's too much, right? That's very much. We need to increase the renewable energy sources in the future. Now, what are the problems associated with fossil fuel? There are many problems associated with fossil fuels. The main problems are global warming, greenhouse gas, acid rains and air pollution. Now, global warming is nothing but the sustained increase of the average temperature of the earth sufficient to cause climate change. That is what is global warming. Basically, here if you see in this animation, you can see that the Arctic ice loss is our main concern. What does this Arctic ice loss mean? Means the ice which is there in the Arctic Circle is getting reduced day by day because of the global warming effect. So that the average temperature of the earth is being increased slowly, because of which the ice is getting melted. Not only Arctic ice, even our own Himalayas and everything, all those things are also getting depleted slowly. If the temperature goes on increasing, the ice which is being there, which is there in the different mountains and everything, will melt, and we can see rise in the ocean level, which is very dangerous for us. Okay, so that is global warming. Next, greenhouse gas. Any gas such as carbon dioxide or chlorofluorocarbons that contribute to greenhouse effect when released into the atmosphere. Greenhouse effect, we know that greenhouse effect is nothing but capturing the heat inside the atmosphere, increasing the temperature of the atmosphere, and again increasing the temperature of the earth. That is the greenhouse effect. So what are the different types of gases that are causing the greenhouse effect? Means carbon dioxide is one of the basic gases which is causing the greenhouse effect. And again, chlorofluorocarbons are also another contributing phenomena for the greenhouse effect. These are the different things which are released when fossil fuels are being burnt. Okay. Next is acid rains. We have seen this acid rains concept quite frequently in the news and everything. Acid rains is nothing but when the air pollution is high and the rain falls, that air and the rain waters mix together and form an acid. That causes a lot of damage. Acid itself causes a lot of damage, right? So acid rains are very dangerous. This is also one of the problems which is being created by the fossil fuels. And again, air pollution. In general, air pollution he's talking about. So these are the basic problems associated with the fossil fuels, which may be reduced by using the renewable energy sources. Energy scenario. Energy is one of the major inputs for the economic development of any country. In the case of the developing countries, the energy sector assumes a critical importance in view of the ever-increasing energy needs requiring huge investments to meet them. So, he is saying that energy is the major input for the economic development. So, we need to be sure how the energy scenario is. Okay, energy can be classified into several types based on the following criteria. This energy can be classified into different types based on criterias. What are the criterias we are taking, that we'll see. So what are the different several types on which these energy can be classified means? The first classification is called as primary and secondary energy. Second classification, commercial and non-commercial energy. Third classification, renewable and non-renewable energy. So primary and secondary energy. What is primary and secondary energy means? As we know, in case of colors or anything, primary colors are there, secondary colors are there. That means you will have a source and will have some other sources which are dependent on the first source. That's what the primary and secondary energy is the concept of. So primary energy sources are those that are found or stored in nature. So those are called as primary energies. So coal, oil, natural gas and biomass are the examples for the primary energy source. Other primary energy sources available include nuclear energy from radioactive substances, thermal energy stored in Earth's interior, that is nothing but the geothermal energy, and potential energy due to Earth's gravity. Potential energy due to Earth's gravity is nothing but hydropower. Primary energy sources are mostly covered in industrial utilities into secondary sources. So primary energies are the main source and secondary energies are the second source. For example, coal, oil or gas converted into steam and electricity. So steam and electricity are the secondary energy sources, whereas coal, oil, gas are the primary energy sources. Just a division. In this diagram, he is showing us how the different types of energies are being produced. If you just look at the second right hand corner, you will see that the secondary energies are defined as steam, thermal, electricity, thermal and steam. What are the primary energies means? Again, we have coal, coal, hydro, nuclear, natural gas and petroleum. These are the basic energies through which the primary energies are being done or being extracted. After that, they are converted into secondary energies. Next, commercial energy and non-commercial energy. Commercial energy. The energy sources that are available in market for a definite price are known as commercial energy. By far, the most popular forms of commercial energy are electricity, coal and refined petroleum products. So, commercial energies are nothing but which are being sold at a particular price. So, the basic examples for the commercial energy are electricity, coal and refined petroleum products. Refined petroleum products is nothing but petrol, kerosene and all those things. Okay, non-commercial energy. Next is non-commercial energy. The energy sources that are not available in commercial market for a price are classified as non-commercial energy. Non-commercial energy sources include fuels such as firewood, cattle dung and agricultural waste, which are traditionally gathered and not bought at a price used especially in rural households. These are also called as traditional fuels. So non-commercial energy are nothing but firewood, which is available to us freely. That means if you want firewood, you can just chop up a tree. That is what he means. Cattle dung is also free because we do not need to ask the cattle or pay the cattle a price. So it's free, right? We can take it freely. And agricultural waste are nothing but after the crop is done, we just throw off all these things. These are the waste things, but these can be used as a energy. That is what is non-commercial energy for. That is what is the non-commercial energy. Again, renewable and non-renewable energy. This we have already seen what is renewable and non-renewable. Still, let us just play along with this. Renewable energy is the energy obtained from the sources that are essentially inexhaustible. So this cannot be exhausted. Examples of renewable energy resources include wind power, solar power, geothermal energy, tidal power and hydroelectric power. So these are the different types of renewable energy sources. Non-renewable energy is the conventional fossil fuels such as coal, oil and gas, which are likely to deplete with time. So these are the different types which this is all just summarizing what we have studied till now, summarizing what we have discussed till now, renewable and non-renewable energy. Now, global primary energy reserves. It is just this total slide is just showing us how much of primary energy reserves are present and what is the global scenario in this primary energy reserves. Okay, it's showing us the amount of coal, oil and gas present in the globe and what are the different leading countries with the coal, oil and gas reserves. Okay, and the last point which we need to keep in mind is that world oil and gas reserves are estimated at just 45 years and 65 years respectively. Coal is likely to last a little over 200 years. So in the global scenario itself, if we keep on using the oil and gas which are reserves which are present in the nature in the same rate as we are using them right now, only oil will be available only for 45 years more and gas will be available only for 65 years more. Coal will be likely to last a little over 200 years. That is after, let us say, after 200 years from now, you won't have any fossil fuels. The oil and gas will be depleted as well as the coal will be depleted. So this is the global primary energy consumption and how we are using all these things. If you just look at this total scenario, you can just see that the renewable energies are very minute, that is just very small. Okay, so we need to increase the renewable energies and we need to curb the oil, natural gas, coal and all those things because they are getting depleted day by day. Energy scenario in India. Now that was the global scenario. Now we are coming to specifically to India. India ranks 6th in the world in total energy consumption. Accounts for 3.4% of the global energy consumption. India is rich in coal and renewable energy sources, but it has very less hydrocarbon reserve. So we have very less hydrocarbon reserve. Okay. India is a net importer of energy. So we are importing energy from other countries, which is a slightly bad thing, right? More than 25% of the primary energy needs is met through imports, mainly from crude oil, mainly in the form of crude oil and natural gas. So that's sad, right? 25% of the primary energy needs are met through imports. That's really sad. Heavy dependence on non-renewable sources of energy, coal, petroleum, natural gas to meet the demand. So this is the scenario, right? Right now this is the scenario. We are depending on non-renewable energy sources, which is a bad thing. Okay. During the pre-reform period, the commercial energy sector was totally regulated by the government. Yeah, whatever the commercial energy we are getting, that is totally regulated by the government. Now it is being a little you know, privatized and everything. The economic reform and liberalization in post-90s has opened the doors for private sector participation in coal, oil, gas and electricity sectors. That is what we were saying. It has been liberalized a little and private sectors are also being involved in the commercial energy sector. Government control. So there are four different ministries which control the Indian energy sector. What are the different ministries means? Ministry of Coal, Ministry of Power, Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. So we have specifically we have four different ministries to control the Indian energy sector. That's that's different, right? That's very good. So this is the introduction which we need to know about the renewable energy systems. Now we are going to see solar energy in particular. So solar energy, this is a renewable form of energy, and for the solar energy, sun is our main source. The sun is a star. Source of energy in the sun is at its core. This energy is released into space primarily as electromagnetic radiation. We experience this radiation as heat and light. So sun is a star, and stars are nothing but the gaseous substances in which there will be nuclear fission and fusion reactions that are being continuously done, or the continuously there will be fusion and fission reactions in the sun. So there will be a large amount of energy that is being liberated from a star. So how is this energy released into space? Means it is primarily an electromagnetic radiation. So we have an electromagnetic radiation that is being released by the sun into the space. That is what we are capturing as heat and light when we come to our earth. Now, how powerful is solar energy? Know how powerful is the solar energy? This one statement can show us how powerful the solar energy is. Every hour, enough sunlight reaches to earth to meet the world's energy demand for a whole year. Just imagine that every hour, in 1 hour, we can just tap this. If we can just tap the whole sunlight that is being, shown on earth, we can just take all the sunlight and convert it into electrical energy. If we can convert for 1 hour, that's enough to run the whole world for 1 year, which is a huge amount of solar energy. Solar irradiance of India. India represents the spot of highest solar insolation, not insulation, ma insolation, I-N-S-O-L-A-T-I-O-N, insolation in the world. Insulation is stopping the sun, but it doesn't stop the sun. India is the highest solar insolation in the world, okay? It has highest amount of solar radiation that is coming to us, okay? India has perfect climate for solar energy. Yeah, our climate is little dry and everything, so which can be useful for us to tap the solar energy. Solar power in India is a fast developing industry with a cumulative installed grid connected solar power capacity of 8 gigawatts as of 31st July 2016. So we have installed capacity of 8 gigawatts, which is very good actually. Indian government significantly expanded its solar plants 100 gigawatts of solar capacity by 2020. So which is really nice amount of energy. We are, as we are a tropical country and we have large amounts of solar energy that is being given to us, that is being shown on earth, and the climate is also suitable for tapping the solar energy. We are leading in the solar energy sector. What is solar energy? Solar energy is defined as energy obtained from the sun's radiation. This is the most readily and abundantly available source of energy. Since ancient times, this energy has been harnessed by humans using a range of innovations and ever-evolving technologies. So, as the definition itself indicates, is defined as energy obtained from the sun's radiation. Solar energy is nothing but energy from sun's radiation. This is readily available and free. Basically, it is free energy and it is available for us readily. We need not to worry about the supply of solar energy. Okay. Since ancient times, this energy has been harnessed by humans using a range of innovations and ever-evolving technologies. That means even before inventing the solar panel and everything, sun's energy has been used. I'll give you a simple example for this. If you remember, we used to do this thing. We used to take a magnifying glass and a paper, and we used to take that magnifying glass to the roof and just concentrate the sun's rays onto the paper until the paper gets lit. If you haven't tried this, you can try this because it's summer and you can just do this. And you, if you see that, they just by concentrating the solar rays to one particular point using a magnifying glass, you can just heat the things up. That means the same technique was being used for several years even before the invention of solar panels to heat up things, to light up things and everything. So that powerful is our solar energy. Now, breakdown of the incoming solar energy. We are just seeing how the solar energy is being how much solar energy is incoming and how much solar energy is being taken by the different parts of the earth. If you just see, incoming solar energy is 174 petawatts. Peta means 10 power 15 watts. That is huge amount of energy. In that 174 petawatts, 89 petawatts is absorbed by lands and oceans. So maximum amount is being absorbed by lands and oceans itself. And then we have reflected by atmosphere. 10 petawatts is being reflected by the atmosphere. Again, 33 is absorbed by the atmosphere. Conduction and rising air is using 12 petawatts. Latent heat of the water vapor. When the oceans get heated, we'll have water vapor rising from the oceans. That is using 40 petawatts. And again, radiation absorbed by the atmosphere. That is again 26. And again, radiated from earth to space. Some of the radiation is given back to the space, that is 10 petawatts, and again radiated to space from atmosphere. Okay, there are showing us in two different ways. From atmosphere, 111 petawatts is being radiated to the space and 10 petawatts is radiated from the earth. Okay, again, reflected by earth surface, 7 petawatts, reflected by clouds, 35 petawatts. So this is just a breakdown of on how much of energy is being given by the sun to us, and again, how much of energy is given out to the space and everything. About half the incoming solar radiation reaches the earth surface. So he's saying in 174 petawatts, will be half of that value will be wasted, and only half of that will be reaching the earth surface. Okay, what are the advantages and disadvantages of solar energy? Advantages: solar energy is free, although there is a cost in building of collectors and other equipment required to convert the solar energy into electricity or hot water. Basically, it is free, but we need the equipment which we are using to tap the solar energy. They cost a little. Okay, solar energy does not cause pollution. There is no byproducts, so there will be no pollution. Solar energy can be used in remote areas where it is too expensive to extend the electricity power grid. So in some areas this transmission cost will be very high because they are far away from the power station and grid and everything. So in order to establish a electrical line, it will take very much more amounts. So in those places, in those remote places, we can use solar energy. We can just put there an independent solar plant, and we can just produce the electricity there and use there itself. So that's the flexibility of solar energy. Many everyday items such as calculators and other low power consuming devices can be powered by solar energy effectively. Yeah, I was just saying this yesterday. Actually, if we just look at the calculator, scientific calculator which we have, in that scientific calculator, you will see a small strip that acts like a solar panel. Okay, it's a small solar cell. Okay, why are we using that panel? Means how are we using that panel means when we just go into when we just expose it to sun or something, it will get recharged, or it will give us a command to off the calculator, even though if you have left it, like if you didn't off and if you left it on for some period, all those things will be done by the small strip. Okay, next, what are the disadvantages? Solar energy can only be harnessed when it is in when it is daytime and sunny. Yeah, so solar energy is not available in the night times. That is a big disadvantage. And even in the rainy season or winter, even in those times, we will not have any solar energy. So that is a disadvantage. Solar collectors, panels and cells are relatively expensive to manufacture. Okay, the collectors, panels and cells which are used to collect the solar energy and reserve the solar energy, these are very expensive to manufacture. Solar power stations can be built, but they do not match the power output of a similar sized conventional power stations. So let us say we have a 100 square meters of area. In that 100 square meters of area, if we are building a solar panel and an equivalent thermal panel, thermal power station, then what happens is the amount of energy which you can get from the thermal power station is much more higher than the amount of energy you can get from the solar power station. Okay, that is the disadvantage of the solar power station. Large areas of land are required to capture the sun's energy. As in case of a hydropower plant for which we need a large catchment area through which we are going to collect the rainwater and store it, in the same manner here we need a large area to capture the sun's energy. Okay, so we need a large amount of area to capture the sun's energy. Solar power is used to charge batteries so that solar power devices can be used at night. However, the batteries are large and heavy and need storage space. They also need replacing from time to time. So now the solar energy is only can only be harnessed in the daytime. So if you need to use electricity in the night time, what we are going to do is we are going to recharge the battery. We are going to take a battery and we are going to charge the batteries when there is sunlight, and then discharge the batteries when there is no sunlight, at night times. But the thing is, these batteries are large and heavy and need storage space, right? They are very large and heavy and they need a separate storage place. Okay, and they also need replacing from time to time. So these are the disadvantages of solar energy. Now, before even going into the solar, what are the different types of solar energies and how we are going to harness them, we need to refresh our memory on some basic topics. That is, the first thing which we are going to see is semiconductor physics. So this is a general topic which you people already know, actually. So we have already studied. So this is the division of solids which we have, that is based upon the electrical conductivity. We are dividing the total solids into three parts, that is conductors, semiconductors and insulators. If you just see here, conductors are nothing but the elements where there are more number of free electrons